start by finding out who I'm talking to. So how many of you consider yourselves polyamorous, whatever that might mean to you? Okay, a few. How many of you don't like labels, but you're doing something kind of out of the box? How many of you have read Love Without Limits, which was my first book in 1992 about responsible non-monogamy, and then reissued in, 1997 as Polyamory, the New Love Without Limits. Anybody read those? A few. Anybody read Polyamory in the 21st Century? No. Anybody read The Seven Natural Laws of Love? Okay.
Just ordered them on Amazon.
They're out of print except for Polyamory in the 21st Century. But maybe you found some used copies. There's a lot of there's been a lot of evolution in even what people think polyamory means. And I started out using the term, the very unsexy term, responsible non-monogamy. But in a way that was more descriptive. And polyamory, literally many loves. But what I was looking at way back in 1992 is that I wanted to describe a way of loving that is not dictated by the mind, the conditioning, but that respected love as a natural force, and that was about being in the truth of how that would express for whoever was involved in a way that is kind, in a way that's transparent, in a way that's authentic, honest. And it's not about the form. So for me, you could not attach to using the word polyamory. In fact, given what's being done in the name of polyamory, I'd kind of rather not use the term polyamory. I went through a phase of, I don't want to be associated with this even. Because it came to mean polyfuckery, which was the reason that we were trying to create a different terminology to distinguish polyamory or responsible non-monogamy for recreational sex. So not that there's anything wrong with recreational sex. Recreational sex is a perfectly fine thing to do, especially if it's done with honesty. But it's very different from the idea of fully showing up in some kind of ongoing way. When I say ongoing, that doesn't have any particular time limit connected with it. I don't necessarily see time as a measure of the success of relating, but we're trying to distinguish it from swinging. And when my first book came out, and I was kind of going around to festivals and conferences promoting the book, and I went to a swinger convention that was held at the Los Angeles Airport Hilton. And I started talking about how I was distinguishing this lifestyle from swinging. And I had a bunch of very angry swingers come up to me afterwards and say, when we started this movement in the 70s, what you're saying is polyamory, that's what we meant. And we have friendships and, you know, we have multi-dimensional experiences. It's not just sex. And it's not just about couples, even though it's kind of hard to get into a swinging convention if you're not a couple, but you're like, it's not about couples, it's not just about sex, it's everything you're saying. And I was sitting at lunch today with someone, maybe you're in the room, was talking about relationship anarchy. And I said, yeah, I said, that's exactly what I meant by polyamory in, 1992. So what I realized is it doesn't matter what words you come up with, those words are going to evolve to mean something very close to what I'll call the old paradigm. And the old paradigm wants to take any effort to change paradigms and include it in the old paradigm and actually bolster the old paradigm. So what's happened over the last few years, when I started doing this 30, 40 years ago, in the United States, you could not get an article about this new kind of relationship, wasn't really new, but different kind of relationship, multiple partner relationship, you could not get that in print. Not in newspapers, not in magazines. You could get on the talk shows, especially during Sweeps Week, when they did the ratings, because that always brought the ratings up. But there was a blackout, and now all of the most prestigious magazines and newspapers in the United States are running stories about how wonderful polyamory is. And there's an attempt to use a new word, new monogamy. And what does that mean, new monogamy? That means basically what we used to mean by open marriage or open relationship. So the words really get in the way, and the words degenerate really quickly. So I totally resonate with all of you who are saying we're not into labels. But then we have the problem of how do we talk about what we're actually doing if we don't have any labels? And one solution is to not talk about it. But then we're kind of back in the old paradigm of just assume things and be secretive and take care of your needs without concern for the consequences. So we have a really short amount of time together today, and I've got decades of stuff I can talk about, and I'm not really interested in sitting up here and talking for 2 hours, although if that's what you all really want, I'm going to do that. But I'd like to just ask any of you who have, what brought you here? Is there something you really want to see addressed, verbally or non-verbally? Is there something you want from this short window we have together? How can I serve you?
You seem a really passionate woman, so I'd like to know what your passion's about this, because I'm still not clear what you are talking about. So could you put some words around, forget the labels, what's important to you, what message would you want to give out in your books? I really would like to know.
Yeah, so what's important to me is more...
airplane mode.
Airplane mode, okay, thank you. What's important to me is more the shift from the old to the new paradigm for relating.
What was the old one?
And the old paradigm is based on security. It's based on everybody's got to do it the same way. That is one man, one woman, married couple or quasi-married couple. That looks like secrecy and lies, rather than risking being honest about what you really want and what you're feeling. It looks like love that is based on, I'll love you if you do what I want, and otherwise I hate you, rather than, the new paradigm is unconditional love. That is, I love you without conditions. I love you regardless of whether you're allowing me to control you. And that's another thing. The old paradigm is all about control. I love you, therefore, I'm entitled to control you. How crazy is that? Versus allowing, I'm here to give you permission, really, to be your fully expressed self. And in the old paradigm, there's quite a lot of shame, guilt, and punishment that goes along with not adhering to whatever the approved form is. And it's also historically been about men owning women and men really being given permission to have affairs outside and women being severely punished for doing the same thing. So the form that we end up in, whether it's being single, whether it's being in a couple, whether it's being in an open couple, whether it's being in a marriage-like relationship with several people, whether it's what I would call an intimate network, which for me is what really works. Does everybody know what I mean by an intimate network?
No. I think it'd be good to break down these pieces, all these categories that you're talking about, how the shape that is quite.
Okay, well let me just see a show of hands. Who here understands what I mean by some of these terms I'm throwing out? Open marriage, closed marriage, intimate network, group marriage. Okay, so not all of you, but a lot of you. And maybe that's something that is better discussed in small group. But let me see a show of hands. If you don't know what these terms mean, you're probably not engaging in them, although you never know. But who here is in a monogamous couple relationship? Anybody? Okay, so number of you. Now, for me, the important thing is not the form, is not whether it's two people who have no other partners, but whether they consciously chose that or whether they're just doing it because somebody said they should. So those of you who just raised your hands, are you in that monogamous couple relationship because somebody said you should or because that's what you really feel in your heart, that that's what you want with the person that you're with at this time?
I have a self-answer, and it's I tried something different in the past, and it caused a lot of hurt.
Okay. Yeah, well, that's actually what I want to address today, is how can we break out of what's familiar and known territory into this magical mystery tour of being in the truth of what is. And this has been a long journey for me, and I'd say it really began back when I was a teenager and I didn't have any of these concepts and I didn't have any of these words. And I just kind of naturally found myself engaging with more than one lover at a time. A handful, really, but more than one. And in fact, there was a group of us, maybe a half dozen of us, as a teenager, that we had this kind of tribal thing going. Men and women, all friends. Sooner or later, we all had sex with each other, at least according to sexual preference. But it wasn't like we said, oh, I'm going to be polyamorous. I mean, there was no such thing. There was a free love movement going on. But somehow that escaped our awareness. And it wasn't till 15 years later, I looked back and I went, I've been doing this for 15 years. It was invisible to me. And I tell a lot of my personal story in various books and articles you'll see on my website, loveandoutlimits.com. So I don't want to go too far back in the story. That would be the end of the 2 hours. I'll just say that I did a lot of exploring of this territory, and I've experienced pretty much every type of relationship that you can imagine, although I've never had a primary partner that was a woman. That's kind of the
next?
Well, I don't know. For a while, I thought that must be next, because I've never done that. But actually, I guess I'm what's called a het-leaning bisexual, meaning I'm mostly interested in men. I'm not that interested in a woman as a primary partner. In fact, I'm not that interested in a primary partner as most people think of it. And in relationship anarchy, there's a challenge of this idea of hierarchies of relationship, at least established hierarchies. And what I really believe in is being authentic and true to the nature of relationship. So if I'm married to you, then I meet this person over here, and somehow over time, the connection develops to be stronger. So even though that person's supposed to be a secondary, for me, it doesn't work, it hasn't worked, and will probably never work to say, I've committed to this person as my primary, and even though things have shifted and what's true and real is now I feel more connected with that person, but I can't allow that to show up in my world. I have to stick with the form that I'm locked into. That doesn't work for me, although it works for a lot of people. And that's really another major, major, major piece of this for me, is that it's not one size fits all. Okay, we all are unique beings. We all have different needs, wants, desires, opportunities, levels of emotional maturity, levels of communication skills, levels of tolerance for the unknown.
I'm just curious about what you're saying, because one way of seeing it is there's always going to be new people that one I could be sexually attracted to. However, if I'm in a long-term relationship, it's about more than just immediate gratification. I'm playing out my patterns. I'm growing as a human being. So that sort of realization that there's always the sweet shop and someone out there who's going to be great for now. But if I go with that person for now, then they'll turn in and they become a primary. I'm back in the same place.
Yeah, that's not what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Yeah. So the kid in the candy store phenomenon. The way I see it, it's very natural, if we're adolescents, to want to explore our sexuality. We want to find out who we are sexually. And in order to do that, we need to interact with a number of different people who reflect different things, who, you could say, are operating a different frequency or something like this. We need to try out different things. If instead, because we are shamed and guilted out of exploring our sexuality as adolescents, which I don't know if it's still going on today, I think it is, but not as much. If we're not able to do that as adolescents instead, or immediately either forced into, okay, now we're engaged and we're getting married, or we're forced into, okay, now we're hooking up, we're having sexual experiences, but there's really no intimacy, and there's really not much communication, and at least for the women, it's not very satisfying. Can't really speak to the men's experience. Either way, we're missing this really important phase of exploring who we are, both sexually and, you could say, romantically. And if we miss that and end up in a long-term marriage or marriage-like relationship, at some point down the line, usually for women it's around menopause, and I think for men it's about the same, we reach a point where we realize, especially if the person we ended up with is not really someone who is suitable as a mate. And I believe most people are settling when they go into an exclusive commitment. Most people are settling. They get to whatever age it is, in which society dictates you should be married, you should have children, women have a clock ticking, and they go for what seems like the best option. Some really fortunate people manage to connect early in life with someone that really meets them on all chakras or many chakras. Most people are not having that experience. So I see it. Very, very few. And very few people are having one partner for life. Anybody here? One partner, either sexual or, you know, committed partnership for life?
Okay. My parents.
You have one partner for life. No
others. My parents.
His parents. His parents.
Your parents.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. In that generation, it was pretty common because people didn't have a lot of options. They were kind of stuck there, whether they liked it or not. And in more traditional societies, there's arranged marriages, which give you actually a better chance of having it work. Because it's not all based on sexual attraction, which, you know, once the hormones wear off, 2 to 4 years, you're on your own. If you're incompatible, you're in trouble. And I'm rambling a bit. It's been an intense festival, but let me try to complete this concept, and I'll take this question back here. So if you're not able to explore sexually early in life, you get to the point where your mortality arises, and you realize, yeah, it's halfway over. If I'm going to explore my sexuality, I better do it now, or I'm going to die. It's going to be too late. And at that point, a lot of people either get divorced or open up their marriage, and then they're the kid in the candy store. And for some people, that goes on and on and on indefinitely, and I won't pull out my psychologist weapons and make them wrong. I'll just say, for some people, it goes on indefinitely. For some people, they have a couple of years of this, and then they go, okay, well, that was interesting. Now I know who I am. Now I know what I want. And if they have done the inner work to be ready to establish an intimate relationship that's sustainable, then they do that. And that may take many different forms. And that's, and polyamory is about respecting diversity. We're all different. It's about choice. We can design our own relationship to meet who we are, and we can take the challenges that come up to support our growth. Now, some people will try to tell you you can only have that kind of relationship as a spiritual path in a monogamous relationship. It's not true. If you want to use monogamy to go to sleep and stay asleep and not face your shadow, you can definitely do that. And if you want to use polyamory or multiple partner relating to stay asleep and not face your shadow and not do your own work, you can do that too. There's no form that has a monopoly on growth potential or on being spiritual. It's not about the form. It's about being willing to show up and deal with whatever comes up. As my teacher said, a commitment not to run out the back door. In other words, not to run because you're scared, you're angry, you're confused. But that doesn't mean you stay there for life if that's not what's appropriate anymore. So when I say somebody over there, I'm married to you, somebody shows up over there, I don't mean somebody that I have a sexual attraction with. I mean someone that my soul is really calling and feeling the synergy, the alignment of being together, that's more alive than maybe over here was alive once and it's died, or maybe over here was desperately feeling it's time to get married, I better do it, and here's a convenient option. I've done all of these things. I've married men who were crazy. I've married men who are the man you're supposed to marry and, you know, have the white picket fence and 2.4 kids and all of that. I've married a man who, at least on paper, was in agreement with having a polyamorous lifestyle, and I've divorced all of them. I've actually been single for, let's see, how long has it been? Around 20 years. My last marriage was an open marriage, meaning you know, we had full permission to have other partners. And actually, our ideal, our intention was to have a group marriage. And in our ceremony, when we got married, we didn't have the other people, but we asked our lovers to stand in as part of the ceremony, and they were wearing masks for the future partners. I mean, that's, you know, really like the vision. Some people have the vision of, I'm going to find my soulmate, and we're going to live happily ever after. And we had the vision, we're going to find our group marriage soulmates. We're going to find our soulmates and get married and live happily ever after. And I have to say, yeah, that marriage had more longevity than the others, but it didn't work. Ultimately, I realized at some point, we're never going to have a group marriage here because the people that he's attracted to and that are attracted to him are not the same people that I'm attracted to and are attracted to me. So this is never going to come together. Small detail. And when I got out of that marriage, I still, see what happened to me was, I realized when I got divorced for the second time at about 30, I realized there was a problem with monogamous marriage, at least for me. And I had just been through a graduate program in clinical psychology, and I had done a dissertation on domestic violence, why women stay or leave a man who are physically abusing them. And I was doing therapy with families that had incest in the family. And I was working with single parent families, and I was seeing, yeah, over half I was focusing on women, but of course half the women, that's also half the men, are in these really dysfunctional, really awful marriages. And they either stay there or they get out. But the point is, it's not a personal problem when half the people are, you know, not only not fully gratified, but really being harmed by the relationships that they're in. And so I started looking for alternatives. And the very first people I ran into happened to be four people in a group marriage that was the most beautiful relationship I had ever seen. To be in contact with these four people was to dive into a pool of unconditional love, completely free of drama, completely synergized. These people were completely devoted to service and had the most beautiful relationship I had seen among any people. And I thought, here it is. This is the solution I'm looking for. Little did I realize, it's extremely rare. Yeah, I still have not seen anyone really operating at that level. And I became part of that extended family. I spent a lot of time with them. And if there's anything being hidden there, you know, you can't hide it in that kind of intimate space with people over time. So this is real. And if I had not had a child, I probably would have joined that family. But they didn't do children in that family. They wanted to serve people outside of the family, and children require a lot of service for a lot of years. And by the time my daughter grew up, I was off to the next thing, thinking, well, I'll just recreate this on my own. And yeah, it took me about 10 years to realize it's not that simple. Really what it requires, yeah, polyamory without tears, polyamory instead of polyagony, really what it requires is getting beyond the ego, getting beyond ego-based relationship. And you don't have to be perfect, but you need to be evolved enough psychologically, spiritually, emotionally, that your stuff is not constantly getting triggered. And this is why people often retreat to monogamy. Not that you can't get triggered. For some people, they're going to get more triggered, actually, in a monogamous relationship. But it's more manageable. There's only two people in that relationship, so only two people can get triggered at one time. You have three people, you have four people, they're all triggered at the same time. Absolutely unworkable. And this is why people run screaming back to what they think is going to be easier. And maybe it is, maybe it isn't. For me, when I first encountered Jack Painter in the pelvic heart integration work, I realized that a lot of the drama that was showing up in at the time, I was living with three men and a woman. And I couldn't understand why the men were always competing with each other. And I did the pelvic heart work and I realized I was contributing to that. I was setting that up. Now, they didn't have to cooperate and go along with it, but yeah, they weren't sufficiently conscious to bust me on it. So, if you have to be beyond ego in order to have really one harmonious relationship, let alone three or four simultaneously, that's why we don't see too many examples of the kind I was talking about earlier, this really completely evolved relationship. And these people did not start out there, but their commitment was to truth. Or as they say, I was looking for God. Not there. They weren't looking for more sex, more partners, more opportunities to create drama or have pleasure. Plenty of that went on, but they were looking for God, they were looking for truth, and they were completely fearless spiritual warriors. Whatever came up, they were willing to be with and deal with internally. And when I encountered the pelvic heart integration work, I found some powerful enough tools that directed my attention from the drama out there to the drama inside. And creating harmony between the four genders. If you went to my talk, I think it was yesterday, yeah, the four genders, or we could just say the man and the woman inside. When they are in harmony, then it gets reflected on the outside. So I had been doing this work for quite a while. All of my existing relationships kind of fell by the wayside. And I realized, okay, the test is coming. And someone came into my life who, for the first time, I really had a totalness for. I talked about people settling. So up until then, I had always been settling. And I really don't want to make this all about me. I'm going to fast forward and just say that that ended in a rather dramatic way, in a heart attack. That's a kind of a metaphor. So up to the present day, what's happening for me in the present day? And there's a lot of rumors out there, by the way. I don't know how familiar you are with the rumor mill in the United States over here, but it's kind of become a global village. So a conservative American magazine recently published an article quoting me as saying that polyamory is a pile of shit. And I immediately had people in the polyamory community going, did you really say that? You know, this article is out there saying you said that. You should get them, you know, you should tell them to not do that. But now I don't really care. It's like, all right. But they seriously misquoted me, and now there's a rumor out there that I think polyamory is a pile of shit. And what's really funny about that to me is that probably this is the first time in my life that whatever polyamory is, I'm not, you know, we kind of talked about what it might be or not be, it's happening really harmoniously for me. And it's happening with really no drama for me. And it's happening in a just totally beautifully supportive, magical way. So it is possible. And how did I get there? Well, that's what I hope to be able to guide you through a bit today. But let me see. You still have your question in the back?
Me, yes.
Yeah?
Because I find it very interesting to figure out how you create a new paradigm which is not like a box, because it's like, you know, we have this one box, and how do we create a new paradigm that isn't then just like a new box? Because I know lots of people who try polyamory and people living in Tamara, and they tell me, oh, and then I meet this lover then, and now I have this new lover, I really want to meet him, but I have all these other lovers, and I go like, well, aren't you in a box again now? So is it more like being in a community and kind of like just agreeing, like we all believe in that, and that's how we create all around that, and is it just like more fluid? Because I'm interested in like concrete examples, like when you talk about the four people or about your relationships, I go like, yeah, but what does it look like in everyday life? How do we agree on who sleeps with whom and what's happening, or how does it look like?
Okay, well, first, yeah, that's kind of why I backed away from polyamory. I realized unintentionally we just created a new box. Because now I had people coming to me going, you know, I really feel like being monogamous, but my boyfriend thinks I should be polyamorous, and all my friends think I should be polyamorous, and can you help me to be more polyamorous? Well, yeah, this is just the mirror image. It's turned inside out. That's not an advance. Diversity is, freedom of choice. To me, that's what polyamory is, letting love flow, not having an idea, now I'm going to put myself in a new box. And by shifting paradigms, we're not creating a new box, we're creating a new way of being. We're creating new values, we could say, or a new state of consciousness, of awareness. And Osho spoke a lot about this. And it hasn't really changed. And it's not about doing whatever you want, whenever you want, with whoever you want. That just kind of creates chaos. And we have to recognize we're human beings. We have sensitivities, needs, desires, vulnerabilities. And we need to consider this. And even if you're mostly egoless, you still can have a yes and a no. This is what I want and need. This is what I don't want and need. And if you're able to know what you need and what you want, and you can communicate about that, and you have a shared intention, not to baby each other, but to be kind and considerate and truthful, it's really, it's simple. It's truly very simple. What's not simple is all the beliefs we have about how it should be, the sense of entitlement, the jealousy triggers, and the jealousy triggers are huge. I have an ebook I've written called Compersion, Meditations on Using Jealousy as a Path to Unconditional Love. It's an ebook. Currently a bit in a bind distributing it because PayPal has decided that after 10 years I'm not fit to be one of their clients because I have the word Tantra on my website. So I've been banned from PayPal. And I need to create another way to receive people's money. Until then, I think I have to give the book away. That will solve that. So if you want a copy of this ebook, email me. I've got a few cards left up on this table. Otherwise, it's just Taj, T-A-J, at lovewithoutlimits.com. Or just go to lovewithoutlimits.com and join my email list. And then email me and tell me you want a copy of Compersion. And you met me at Osho Leela, and I'll send it to you. Compersion. Compersion is a made-up word. It's created by the Carista Commune, which was a 30-year experiment in group marriage, which, you know, something lasts for 30 years. They figured out something. But the level of consciousness there is so much lower than the people that I was talking about that can't even compare them. But they were really good at inventing words and language. And they had, at one point, a social contract that had about 100 items on it of things you needed to agree with in order to be in that marriage or in that commune. And it was about 30 people at the maximum, divided into different families, just like they do here at the Tantra Festival. Like other tribes, but, and they were just about that fluid. I mean, you could decide one day, this group is my family, and the next day, oh, I want to have sex with that person. Okay, now I'm in a family with that person. It was very fluid. So they didn't believe in sex outside of marriage. They were polyfidelitous, but you could get married and unmarried like this. I mean, it wasn't a legal marriage, because you can't legally marry more than one person anyway. So they came up with the word compersion, which is a really good word that describes the opposite of jealousy. Now, we might not all agree what jealousy is. And the way I define jealousy is it's not about what's causing the jealousy, it's about the internal state. And it's an internal state in which my heart is really open and expanded, and my sex, as Marta and Robert so beautifully call it, my sex, my second chakra, my genitals, I think I just like this expression, sex, is really open. You know, they're talking about this right here. This is open, and my heart's open and expanded. Kind of the state you're probably all in, or many of you are in, after, you know, several days at the Tantra Festival. So that, there's simultaneously this movement to expand, and at the same time, there's fear, which is a movement to contract, and to protect my vulnerable heart, and my vulnerable yoni, and my vulnerable belly. And at the same time, there's sexual arousal running. And this is a pretty overwhelming emotional state. It's this simultaneous pull to expand and contract. And that's what creates this really uncomfortable feeling inside. Anybody know this uncomfortable feeling inside? Yeah. Yeah. So there's different strategies for dealing with jealousy. And this is kind of my intention today, because I see once people let go of the moral judgment that you shouldn't allow yourself to love or be sexual with more than one person, and once you let go of the the need to conform, what's really in the way of allowing love to flow is jealousy. And it's not that you can avoid jealousy in monogamy. I'm not even sure you can avoid jealousy in celibacy. But you can kind of sweep it under the carpet and not have it in your face constantly. So, if we can transcend jealousy, we can actually not just transcend it, but allow it to be one of the most powerful teachers you will ever encounter. Now, there is nothing that's going to show you more quickly where you're still attached, where you're in your ego, than something that's triggering your jealousy. If only the jealousy is not so big that you're flooded, you're overwhelmed, you're traumatized by it. And at that point, really all you can do is breathe. You know, maybe do some play fighting or kickboxing or, yeah, in some way, you know, run a marathon, in some way try to release the energy. But if you have just enough jealousy to make you uncomfortable and still able to function and to inquire inside, what's going on? What's triggering this? And what kind of support do I need from my inner man and my inner woman to move through this? Then jealousy becomes a really powerful teacher. So is there anyone who would like to explore this possibility of dealing with jealousy? Okay, those of you who are raising your hands, are any of you here with a partner? No? Nope, no people here with a partner who would like to explore your jealousy. Interesting. Okay, well, we can explore it anyway. You have an attraction? Is it?
We've connected here, we're both... Yeah, but we're not a couple. So if it could be useful.
Yeah, that's fine. That's perfect. It should be in a certain way, that you're going to be left, that you're going to be abandoned, that you're going to... the Compersion ebook gives you a menu of choices of what those messages might be. And some people are using them like tarot cards. They open it to a certain page, and it's just a short little meditation about what might be underneath the jealousy. So first you identify one or more things that are being triggered. Then you see what the antidote is. What do you want to replace the tape that says, I'm not good enough, with, you're perfect just the way you are. You're beautiful. You're lovable. You used to have people sit in a circle. That would be fun to do. We have time to do that. To sit in a circle and receive the message, you're totally lovable, from several people. Anybody want to try that on? Does that sound like fun? Yeah. Not really, sort of, maybe? Yeah. Okay, so you identify what do you need to hear. And for a lot of people, it's going to really be to get, you're lovable, you're loved, I'm here, I'm not going anywhere. That's the inner man and the inner woman that are not undermining, not criticizing, not judging all of those tapes. It's much easier to replace the painful undermining tape, the old paradigm tape, with the new paradigm tape. I love you just the way you are.
Are you suggesting practically that when you come into this situation and experience jealousy, the action that you take is to bring together physically a number of people to tell you that you are good enough and lovable?
Well, you know, if you have that option, that's a good one. And that's what you can do in communities where, or networks, you don't have to be living with the people, but if you have a support network, you can do that. But you actually don't need any other people. You just need to practice those messages. Some people tell me they've recorded them on their smartphones, so in case they're not feeling grounded enough to remember what to say and to say it, they just play the tape. And it works, actually.
I was just going to share after it, and what's really powerful is if you stand up into the mirror and repeat those as a mantra, kind of look into your eyes and hold it.
Mm-hmm. And it's not just about the words. You can go get a massage. You can, you know, find ways to nurture yourself so that you're not so dependent on whoever it is that you're afraid you might lose to feel okay. Now, I had to go into, 10 years, really, of not having significant relationship. I still had my intimate network. I still had friends and lovers, really long-term committed friends that I was sometimes lovers with. And, that was kind of out there as my safety net, people I knew I could turn to if I just couldn't get through this myself. I had to spend 10 years on my own to really get that I don't need anybody out there in order to feel okay. And the hardest thing for me, really, was the social thing. And it's, I don't know if it's as strong for men as it is for women, but, you know, if you don't have a partner, there's something wrong with you. And, you know, we take this in and we believe it. So it took me quite a while to really get over that. So learning to nurture yourself, or some people call it self-love, but actually even beyond that, this is the enlightenment piece. So this, what we just saw, is kind of like the first aid. And the self-care, as some people are calling it, that's the ongoing maintenance. But really, the only solution is to recognize that I am not this body. I am not this story in my head. I actually am love in the core of my being. I am love. And that longing to be loved, if you turn around and follow it back to the source, and if you can stay with that process instead of escaping out into the latest romantic attraction or sexual interest, it will take you there. Yeah. Yeah, so the universe, it's been said, is a giant copy machine. And whatever relationship is going on inside, between the man and the woman inside, that's what's going to show up on the outside. So if the man and the woman inside, the woman is pursuing the man's not interested, that's what's going to show up outside. The woman inside feels the man is not really showing up and can never show up for her. That's what's going to go on inside, outside. If you can rewrite that story inside and be willing to have a new experience, because we get very attached to the old familiar experiences. There's a certain safety and security in what's familiar. And if what's familiar is, let's say, not being able to find a partner and feeling miserable about that, you've got to let that go in order to have a different experience. And it brings up a whole new set of challenges. If you can really work with it on the inside, and this is road tested, this is not theory, what shows up outside is the most amazing, magical support, and it might not look the way you think it should, but if you go by what it feels like, and that feeling is on the inside, it can only be a match. There's a lot of talk about the law of attraction, and I go into this quite a bit in the Seven Natural Laws of Love. This law of attraction is misunderstood in all kinds of, to me, really distressing ways. But the way in which it's true is that your internal state is going to be reflected on the outside. And if your internal state is love, that's what you're going to attract. You can play with this with the yellow jackets that are all around. because if they experience love, they get near you and they feel love, you know, they buzz around for a while and leave. If they start buzzing around and you get angry or fearful, they're totally in your face. Anyone ever notice this? That's a little bit more challenging when they're crawling on your lip, or you're not wearing any clothes and they're crawling on your genitals. A little more difficult to maintain the state of love. But if you can do it then, actually, you know that you've kind of got it down. And that's why this totally lovable thing is really useful. So before the time gets too short, I invite you to kind of spread out into the room with a group of, maybe about six people or so. Any gender, it doesn't matter, but maybe a mix is nice. So make a little circle. We can have one here, we can have one over here, we can have one in the middle. Little circle of six people.